So I have the unenviable task of talking about the future of technology in 15 minutes. If you could imagine the number of changes that have happened just within the last 5 years, you know that in the next 5 years, it's probably impossible to imagine that. A little bit about my background, I just want to highlight the last bullet on here, and that whenever I have students in the audience, I always ask to connect with me on LinkedIn. Part of my give back to the community is to help connect you with other people in the area that you may be interested in. I'm one of the earliest users of LinkedIn, and I think I've got something like 13 million good friends now on LinkedIn. This problem of how do you talk about the future of technology, Gary Hamel, a strategy professor at University of Michigan, you really said that if you're a CIO to figure out what's going to happen in the future with technology, you better start hanging out with people that are under 25. So I took him seriously, and I found a group of high school students with their teacher in Colorado in the U.S. who did this wonderful little video called Did You Know? And they then have updated it every year. So I'm going to just play for you the little clip of the latest version of this. And as you watch it, see which fact or which piece of information jumps out at you.
I love you.
The students who did this in Colorado deserve all the applause. Let's just get the presentation back up. There we go. I don't know whether you noticed, one of the most amazing things about that presentation was that more than half of the slides, probably two-thirds of the slides, are about today. And so even though there are some fantastic statistics, some actually overwhelming pieces of information in that presentation, most of it's about today. That's rather staggering, if you think about it. And it also requires a great deal of humility if you're going to talk about the future of technology. There's three themes I want to pull out of that presentation, because it really is about an explosion of things. There's an explosion of information, there's an explosion of connected users, and an explosion of applications. Let me just take each of those three. There was a wonderful piece of information that said there was, I think it was 40 to the 29th power of information is created just this year, and it's doubling every 2 years, you saw on one of those slides. This piece of information from one of the storage companies, Infographics, says, to put that in perspective, that's about almost as many bits of information as there are stars in the universe. And it's just an overwhelming amount of information. And this one I particularly like. I was actually talking to Omar about this before the event began tonight. Mary Meeker, who at Morgan Stanley is one of the premier analysts in the technology space. That yellow line is mobile internet users, and the green line is desktop or laptop internet users. And you can see that that line crosses next year, according to the forecast. So there are, as of this month, 7 billion mobile phones in the world, equal to the population. That's going to grow by another 50% in just another 5 years. But the key, one of the key themes here is that the focus of technology for the future is the mobile phone. It's not the PC, not the laptop, not the tablet, it's the phone. We also see an explosion of applications. This is some information that was available on ask.com about the various announcements that have been made about the number of applications on iPad and iPhone, and I believe the colors are reversed on this, where iPhone should be the red line on top. But what you can see, in essence, is that 1 million, we're approaching very quickly, 1 million applications available on the iPhone App Store. And that's a staggering amount of applications. How many of those do you really think are good? Maybe 100? Maybe 200? But it's a market. The market will determine, in essence, what is really good technology. That's totally turning the world of technology in the social sector upside down. It's not something we design for beneficiaries or for the social sectors. It's actually going to be more things we discover that's already happening. We have a project that we did at the Federation surveying actually this represents 100 of our national societies, of 187 national societies, so it's 100 countries. The different colors of the different regions, and we, with Accenture, we developed an ICT capacity index among their societies and graphed it versus the Human Development Index on the left. And it's pretty much a, for those of you who like statistics, the regression line through that is almost perfect in terms of the relationship between economic situation and our 18-factor IT index. The problem that we discovered, and this is probably a bit of the obvious for all of you, is that those in the north and the west are up in the upper box, and those that are in the south and in largely in Africa are in the lower box. And even within our social organization, the Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, there's a huge digital divide. And that divide mirrors also the divide that's in the society. So even though all this wonderful technology is happening, even though there's this wonderful penetration of mobile phones and this wonderful explosion of information, we have to keep in mind that still there is a division that exists across our planet in terms of those who have access. So what does all that mean for humanitarian work? five shifts and then seven themes, but I'm not going to have time to talk about all of those. So I've just pulled out a few that I'll highlight, and then we'll post the slide deck online so you can see the rest. The shift to mobiles I've already talked about. The shift to local emergency response is something that we are deeply involved in, about training local communities to respond to disasters themselves, to preparedness. Our Secretary General says that a U.S. dollar of preparedness equals about $4 of relief. And so preparedness is a smart thing to do. And a lot of that is about information dissemination. The death toll in Bangladesh over the last 30 years in terms of major cyclones has dropped dramatically, largely due to preparedness and advanced warnings and shelters that have been prepared in the country. A shift to the beneficiary, and that's really flipping the world upside down for nonprofit organizations. We actually believe now that most of the really important technology applications in the social sector are going to come from citizens and beneficiaries. They're not going to be things that we create and provide, but rather that direction is going to reverse. And then collaboration, something I've been involved in for the past dozen years with the NetHope organization, saying that to be successful in the future, to get technology right in the social sector, it really is about partnering and doing things jointly together, sharing information openly, rather than keeping it in silos. So just the three of the seven trends that I wanted to highlight. We've already touched on this in terms of the mobile technology, reaching people where they are with communications that with which they're already familiar. Haiti was, I think, a tipping point where we saw two things happen with mobile phones. We saw citizens tweeting in and texting in information about the situation that they were experiencing on the ground. We also then hit a tipping point in terms of reaching donors in the U.S., where in the first weekend, I believe the number was north of $20 million raised just through $10 donations through SMS text codes. So that's, the world is different in terms of connecting and reaching people. And that means that all of us in the social sector have to have a mobile strategy as part of our overall development programs, as part of each development program. Another trend is that corporations are going to be asking us to become part of their social responsibility and their program and their response to disasters. We saw this happen in Katrina, where Walmart said, we've got a warehouse full of goods in Baton Rouge and Louisiana, and we're thinking of distributing these the supplies to people in New Orleans. Do you want to come and join us on that? Can you imagine that amount of reversal? Or instead of being the one who's organizing and delivering, we're being asked to join a corporation that wants to take that responsibility. Why? Not because the corporation is primarily interested in altruism, but because their employees demand it. You cannot attract and retain employees in today's world unless you have an engaging social responsibility program. And for all the negative things you may say about Walmart, they got this one right. So partnering side by side, collaborating with corporations. And then the third